Merchant Center Mastery. So we're going to talk about the ID today, the product attribute ID. This is the product attribute that everything else hinges on. And initially, to be honest, I was like, man, the item ID, I don't know if I want to talk about it. And the more I was doing some prep work, the more I was like, gosh, this is actually a really important video. So stay tuned, dig in. We'll have some different tips and things like that as well. First thing off, let's just kind of work our way briefly through Google Merchant Center's help doc here on the ID. And this is interesting. I think I've mentioned this before, but I've read these documents for years. I'll go back and read them for various things. And they've definitely changed in a good way, giving additional information on some of these that's actually incredibly helpful. And so they've done that with the ID. And so I wanted to point some of those things out, but just initially, your ID is, think of this as, this is a Google number thing, okay? Number, whatever. This is a Google entity. This is not the same as your, maybe your product, your manufacturing product number, your MPN, or your SKU, which is, you know, usually your internal number, categorization number, or even you might have a product part number, whatever. This is just Google. So first of all, like, it doesn't matter what the ID is at all. It just has to be unique. And I mean, it has to like match up with their things, their requirements, right? But you can make it whatever you want. I would agree with Google in kind of like best practices. I think that actually like setting it as your SKU can be a helpful way to think about utilizing and creating the ID if you don't actually have numbers. Now, here's the thing. I'm going to hop over to Shopify. This is a client where we're utilizing the Simprosys app. You don't have to use that one. This is just, you know, somewhat of a one that we've used. And let me show you here. So what happens with Shopify is typically that, you know, your Shopify product ID, and I think the item group ID is in there, I believe, as well. Like that's usually assigned with like your variants. You have your main product ID, and then you have variant IDs, and then oftentimes you'll see like Shopify and the country code. So it's really important to realize with ID that you assign it, and you can make it what you want, but then you've got to keep it as that the rest of its life, basically, within Google, all right? Unless you want to totally nuke that. And, we can talk about that. But this is one of the things that Google has actually annotated that I've seen, which is really interesting. Let's see if I can find it now. Right here. They actually, I've never seen them say this before. So they say, I mean, it's been here a little bit, but like, this used to not be here. It identifies the product, your ID. It's used to track the product's performance history in Merchant Center and Google Ads. So if you change the ID, you'll overwrite your product and its history. We have seen that directly impact performance. Okay. So I'm convinced that it actually does impact your ranking, your bids, all of that. So you do not want to change up the item ID number unless that can actually be a way of resetting the system. So sometimes you might get a product that starts to get like on Google's bad side, and you just get tons of like, disapproval filled, you're in their automated filters within Merch Center. You keep getting them disapproved. Resetting your ID can oftentimes help with that. Resetting it, changing it to something else. The only thing I'll say back to, let's say, our Shopify example is, you do want to have some sort of system. This is the balance of feed optimization I found. You need to like have the ability to optimize, which often means manual changes, but you also need some sort of dynamic system that automatically populates things so that you're just not always endlessly doing work, right? And so the thing with IDs are you don't really want to manually change them as much as possible because you want that to be served by your content provider, you know, by Shopify. All that to say, as much as possible, like, utilize whatever your system's IDs are. Although sometimes, every once in a while, we'll have a client where they need like 7 products, and we'll just manually create the feed for them in a spreadsheet. And then typically what I'm doing is utilizing the SKU, if they're not on Shopify, I'm utilizing the SKU usually as that, as the product ID. Let me throw out a caution here, a common mistake that can be that can happen with the item ID. A caution would be if you are changing feeds, okay? So in the event of a feed transition, and we've had videos on that, and we'll probably have more things to be cautious about. Probably the number one thing to be cautious about is not letting your IDs change. That is, I think, the single biggest thing that we tell clients. So let's say you have a client on some platform like Feedonomics, and you and your Shopify, and you want to bring it into an API app within Shopify that will feed into Merchant Center. Be very careful that you maintain your IDs as much as possible. Let's say Feedonomics has been serving this, or maybe you have a custom solution with your website. Let's say you've been serving that and you're just using your Shopify variant ID. When you set up an app like Simprosys, make sure you check the correct one to maintain the IDs. So don't be serving it in this old system and then suddenly switch to like the global format or something like that. That's pretty crucial. Let's get back to maybe some best practices. So, you know, selecting and keeping the ID is important. So here's one thing that I somewhat disagree with here in their help documentation that I wanted to know. Otherwise, you know, you can read this. It's all kind of fairly obvious stuff. But one thing I want you to ponder would be, at times we will have a client do a refresh of a product and they ask us, hey, should we keep the old ID? So here's my thought. If this product in your system is basically taking over for the old product and it's for the most part basically the same thing, then yes, I disagree with Google. I think you should recycle that old ID and put it on that new product, because it's I've written, you know, couple books, and one of the books I wrote, PPC Ponderings, I wrote that right after COVID, and there's some things in there that I like don't agree with anymore, or that I change, whatever. And so I recently did an updated version. One of the things I was trying to determine, I decided I actually wanted to pull the old one off the market. All right, it just there are certain things about it that I just don't like, so I actually wanted to pull that off and replace it with this new one. So even though there are quite a bit of differences, honestly, I still want it to be like PPC Ponderings. That would be an example where I would actually want to maintain my ID in Merchant Center if I were so inclined to be advertising in shopping ads. Where maybe you want to consider not would be if you have that old product still for sale, even if you're not manufacturing it anymore, or if it is such a different product. If it's a totally different product, don't recycle the ID. But I do think there's a good strong argument in like the example I shared for maintaining and recycling that ID as much as possible. So that's just something to be aware of. Another thing to think through with IDs is, or at least to be aware of, is IDs are really going to be the core of how you tie product information into Merchant Center. So what I mean by that is, let's say you want to do a supplemental data feed, all right? What you would want to do with this is you'd want to go in, we've had videos about this before, so you can check those out in terms of how to create a supplemental data source or feed. But what you do is you have your columns, and all you need to do is to have the column of the thing you want to change and the ID. That's all you need to do. Sometimes I'll see people do supplemental feeds where there's just where they've basically hard coded in their entire feed. They've copied and pasted that into a supplemental feed. And the problem with that is that you're basically telling Google whatever is in here is now static and hard coded in, and it will continue to overwrite any feed changes that you send in your regular feed. Okay. So that's why it's very important to keep supplemental data sources updated, and to only change the information and to only include the information you want changed. So let's say in my PPC Ponderings, that is a terrible ID, but there it is. Let's say that's my book ID that I'm sending in my actual feed. And I want to make a custom label saying, this is my top product. And then maybe I'm going to create a campaign, you know, targeting just what are my top products. This is how you do that. You tie that through the ID, making sure your ID matches entirely. Now, an old thing to be aware of, and I'm not sure if this has been changed because I haven't really messed around with it recently, but a huge frustration in the past, and I will save you so much time trying to figure this out. If it's still a problem. A huge frustration in the past is that your ID is case sensitive. I've seen people where they'll like copy, they'll copy and paste and just throw in like Shopify, and this is it right here. Shopify, and then they got like their number, all right? So that's Shopify. And they'll try to connect it, and Google will be like, hey, nope, sorry, like we can't find this product. And you're like looking, you're like, but I see, and you're comparing the numbers, you're looking, you're like, but I see the, I see it right there. Here is your problem. I will save you a million minutes of time. Make that capitalized, and then it will connect. Again, I'm not sure if Google fixed that, but in the old days, that has been a very big frustration. I've had people contact me and they're like, I cannot figure this out. I've spent so much time. And literally I go and I'm like, there it is. Good old capitalization. And it's that darn, and it's like, and it's caught us all before. It's that darn, it's like that darn US and Shopify. So, oh, here's another big thing I want to talk through. And that is the usage of IDs for dynamic remarketing, as well as on your site. See, there's so much that's important about the product ID. So if you remember, dynamic remarketing is something used in PMax, it's used in demand gen, it's used, it can be used in display remarketing as well. And that is basically just ads. And I'll try to find some for you and throw them here on the screen. It's just ads where there are multiple individual products. And those are actually products for dynamic remarketing. Those are products that consumers have actually visited on your site. Dynamic prospecting, by the way, is different. It is your products, but it's products the user has not looked at, but Google thinks based on their information about that user that they have, like contextual information, past search history, stuff like that. It's a little scary, to be honest, but they have all this information. They're like, hey, I think Kirk would like exactly these car parts. Okay, that's dynamic prospecting. I haven't visited the site. Dynamic remarketing, you visited the site and I visited these specific products, and now I see those specific products all throughout the web on your ads, right? So how they're doing that is by utilizing structured markup on the page and then matching that to your Google shopping feed. It's actually pretty simple, and it uses the ID, which is why it's really crucial. And you can go and test it with this testing tool. So we're gonna test it on this page. Okay, so now we have, so we go on our page, let's check this out. And there it is, product ID. Oh, I guess their product ID is 9221. Well, there you go. It's not their SKU. Well, there you go. Oh, it's their model. Oh, that's kind of interesting. By the way, did you realize that you could see, I mean, you could see all of this. So, on a random page, right? This is increasingly what Google's going to turn into your feed, by the way, is they're just going to be pulling all this information, throwing that into Merch Center. And they already do that, if you remember, based on Google Merchant Centers found by Google. This is what they're utilizing, schema markup, as well as I think robots crawl the site and stuff like that. All that to say, so this, your product ID is here. And so if this company is advertising on Google Shopping, then this product would be 9221 as well. And so this is how Google is matching a visitor to this page with Google Shopping, and that's how it serves a dynamic remarketing feed, which is also why it's important that you have your schema markup set correctly. If you're using Shopify, a lot of that stuff is taken care of automatically, which is really nice. So I think that is just about the most important information and the brain dump that I have on the item ID attribute. As you can tell, it's not just a matter of toss a number up. There's actually some important things that you should know about it. Now you know those things, at least you know what I know about it. That's it. That's all I got for you. So thanks and keep learning.